So, ladies and gentlemen, the sun went down, but we cannot. So, let's see the European Stability Mechanism. Actually, first, we have to talk about that how prepared was the Eurozone for the default of the member states. They were not. Even they were saying that if you go to default, that was the Lisbon Treaty in 2009, that even if a member state will go to default, then they will never bail out. Which is a nice thing, until you are not going to default because of Greece, because you are burning money away, why not? So not a hedonistic default is happening, but because if you are going to default due to your banking system. And maybe that was the point when they realized that what can we do with this? So, first, IMF can be used. And IMF, the using IMF funds is rational because last video I mentioned that actually 30% of the quota and the capital is paid in by countries from the Eurozone, so, or the European Union, but still, so it's highly important. And also, first they try to deal with ad hoc intergovernments, but it needed institutions. Institutionalization is really good because it can reduce the moral hazard and cherry-picking behavior on the market. So, because the problem was actually that cherry picking happened. If we have to define it well, now, okay, I don't have my internet, but so cherry picking means that before the crisis, usually long-term interest rates or government bond yields were around between 2 and 4%, and and they were converging, so their correlation was really strong. But once crisis hit, and market participants who at least remained on the market, so all the investors that remained and had some money, they had to be really careful. So their risk awareness increased. And risk awareness increase means that actually they started to look on what they are funding, and they realized that, okay, if we are funding a Germany, it's reliable. If we are funding some other Mediterranean countries, they are not so, or their banking system is not so reliable because they have an increasing share or increasing ratio of non-performing loans. So in this case, it already requires bailouts from the government. So it increases the public debt dramatically. So it's not a fiscal, it's a banking system related crisis at this point. And yeah, so as a result, the European Stability Mechanism was created after some temporary arrangement, and there are rumors or talks about this European Monetary Fund, but actually for me it doesn't matter. So what we need here, some institution which should be part of the legislation, because right now European Stability Mechanism is not part of the treaty about the European Union. It's was made by the governments who are inside the Eurozone. How the liabilities are collected. So I mentioned already the IMF, when if you are member state, then you can lend to the IMF. And so actually member states are taking up or issuing government bonds, collecting the capital, then lending to the IMF, then the IMF will lend it out because markets are not able to fund the country. So if you are not paying back the loan, then actually you are making US or the European Union angry because they are the country who are funding, or territories which are funding this, or China or Saudi Arabia, yeah, all those countries what you don't want to make angry. In the case of the ESM, it's different because actually there is a paid-in capital, which is a lot, 80 billion euros, and losses of the lending should be absorbed by the paid in capital. So, and on this basis, they have the mandate to issue bonds until reaching, so this is the upper limit, 500 million euros. And this is the top, so right now this is the amount of money which was issued in bonds. And after that, what is another feature? So they are issuing the bonds. You can remember that at this time, when they were trying to find a solution on this issue, there were ideas to issue bonds together. So that was the crazy idea of Eurobond. And it's a nice concept, just if you are issuing together, then how can you separate that? Okay, I issued bonds, then I have to allocate some money to Germany, some to Spain, and so on. So it seems to be nice from financial point of view. From political point of view, that would be a complete nightmare without a federal budget. So even in the US, we can see that there is a federal budget, they have the federal public debt. So in this case, it's simple, but issuing bonds on federal level and funding so-called regional, so member state budget from this thing, it would be a hard thing to do. So, yeah. So that's why they had to make. So actually, this is the Eurobond of the not so well performing member states, because still we can say that the bond issuance is organized by the ESM, and the allocation is made by the European Commission. So it's still, we have this interrelation between the different layers. But actually, it's a really good asset. So if we can see that, I mentioned several videos ago that there is a huge scarcity of high quality assets. And right now we can see that if you are purchasing it, then it's AAA. So this is high quality, excellent rated bonds. And which means that if a bank holds it in their asset side, then they don't have to have any kind of risk weighting. So you know that if you have an asset, so you are lending or having a bond in your balance sheet as a bank on the asset side, then 8% of the value of this asset should be included in your equity, because this is what will absorb losses on this asset. But there are exceptional cases. So for example, in this case, we can say that you don't have to make it. So it's a enormous motivator. And what is also really important here, that it's long term. So yeah, there are short term bonds, but also it's way longer what they can issue on the market than what we were able to find or see at the case of the IMF, because 45 year maturity, come on people, it's enormous. And lending. So first of all, ESM has no intelligence at all. They are just collecting the money, and then all the allocation will be decided by the Commission. It's really important, because in the case of the IMF, they have all the analyzing power. They are making annual country reports. If the country needs funding, then the contract will be based on the already existing country reports and recommendations. So the IMF is intelligent. The ESM is not, because they are just a piggy bank. So in this case, we can see that, oh, they have the money. And after that, they can say that we can provide you long-term loans. So at least amortization can start at, usually at least in the past years or in the past contracts, 19 years after you get the money, then you have to start to amortize it. And You have to do it for the next 23 years. So again, you can later we will see that, for example, Greece had this debt funding from the ESM until 2060 something. So it's extraordinary compared to the IMF's. Well, maybe you have 10 years if you are lucky. Type of lending. But until you are stick with the European Commission requirements. So it's really nice that one or two member states are always trying that, oh, we don't want to have this supervision from the European Commission. Come on, in this case you have to have maintain a reliable public budget, you have to maintain a strictly supervised financial system, and in this case you will be not the subject of the European Commission audience and supervision. Otherwise, if you are using the money, yeah. And also downsizing country's financial sector. Yeah, several, maybe 2 years ago, 3 years ago, there were articles when they were crying that, oh my god, European banks are shrinking and we are not able to catch up with US banks, which are also shrinking, but we are not able to catch up with East Asian banks. And size in this case, at this level, is a bad thing, ladies and gentlemen. So you are reaching a level when you are not able to bail out your banking system because next day you will go to default. Then it's time for downsizing. Structural reforms. Yeah, I like this because usually it's a number one on bullshit bingo in macroeconomics, because if you can see that the country is completely messed up in all possible directions, then you can say that they should follow, conduct some structural reforms, so you have to change all your institutions, legal system, partially sometimes even, financial system, taxation, so everything should be refurbished. So this is what structural reforms are meaning here. Privatization, yeah, I mentioned already that in this case you have to reduce your debt by selling your assets, or to your balance sheet will decrease. Actually, if you are interested in the details of the ESM, I can recommend you this paper, what is available online. We were writing it for actually this occasion because we realized that there is no comparison between the IMF and the ESM, so it was highly interesting to write it a year ago. And which member states were supported by the ESM? Actually, in this case, I recommend you to read the story because it's really long. Mostly we can say that in some cases, conventional funding of the fiscal policy was necessary. In some cases, the banking system had to be bailed out, like Spain. In conventional loans, yeah, it's, you can find here Greece, Portugal, Cyprus, but Cyprus, or in Ireland, we can see that also banking system had a crucial importance in the all the mess that happened there. And after that, we can see the story, but there are many sources about it, articles, and so on. Just in the case of Greece, I want to talk about some issues, because first of all, the entire nightmare started here in 2010. And as a result of all the magic that the European Union made, and sometimes the IMF, they were able to go back on market financing, at least for the expiring debt and the new debt, in 2018. So for 8 years, they were going back and forth. So we can see that they received some bilateral loans, IMF funding, European Financial Stability Fund, it was just a temporary arrangement. It was the predecessor of the ESM, also some money from the IMF. It was still not enough, so ESM provided additional funds. Huge amount of money was actually, if you are looking on the data, then all the long-term debt of Greece was funded by the ESM or the IMF at this point. So we can see that also privately owned bonds were subject to a haircut. So Greek sovereign bonds were swapped with ESF bonds. So it was a debt reduction-ish thing. And we can see that, yeah, it's a major importance what is in the hand of the ESM right now. And actual repayment period, yes, we can see that it's really long. And which means that actually the earlier 25% yield was reduced to 1 or 2% last year. So there was a drastic reduction in the case of the price of the public debt. And also, what is not so common, because ESM always provides flexible interest loans. So they are not running any kind of interest rate risk, but here they were able to convert also with fixed interest rate loans. So actually, it's really cheap funding. So not only scattering all the debt in time, but also the price of the funding is really cheap. And we can see that most of the money was used on debt servicing. The remaining was used for building a cash buffer, so short-term funding of the budget because of missing tax incomes. And as we can see that clearance areas, so invoices shouldn't be paid, and bank recapitalization was necessary. And if we are reading the story, well, then actually ESM has nothing, or sorry, not the ESM, but the European Union has nothing drastic from the Greece. So if you are looking on this terrible austerity, why Athens was burning so many times, so they were asking for a budget surplus. If half of the continent funds you, then I think it's reliable, because you were able to see that lots of money was spent on them. Then, value-added tax have to be increased. It's Hungarian point of view, where we have 27% of VAT, it's so cute. Corporate income tax should be increased. Maybe we can think about it, that how it supports growth, but yeah, okay. Luxury taxes. So if you have a private island, a private jet, boat, yacht, and so on, then you have to pay it. And it's so cute that it's increased, but you have to collect it. Come on. It's a tax. It should be collected. So it's not just writing down numbers. Defense expenditure cuts. Yeah, somewhere you have to cut the budget as well. Retirement age increase to 67 years until 2022. Oh, come on. It's also necessary. Anti-corruption measurements. Wage cuts in public sector, don't have to provide 13 or 14 months salary, for example. Autonomous tax authority and statistical office. So my main question is, what was that before? We are not talking about some banana republic at Bumbo Bumbo Island. We are talking about a member state of the European Union and inside the Eurozone. So this is the elite of the, or sorry, it's supposed to be the elite of the elite group. Privatization, regional airports, harbors, electricity grid, and whatever they have. And In this case, number of public servants fall by quarter, and public sector wages dropped by 30%, and unemployment was really high. And they were asking this thing. So if you are checking the contracts, they were not the enemy of Greece. Actually, they were asking for a performing and reliable budget. That's all what we can have here. So that's why it's a disaster for me. But, oh, Greece, poor Greece, due to austerity, we should do something with them. No, it's not. It's never like this. Also, we can find Cyprus, Portugal, and Spanish case, and Ireland here. You can read the paper. I don't want to talk about them, because in Spain, the Spanish case, I mentioned it so many times. And actually, they needed short funding only on 2 years basis, so we can see that they were never the victim of bad fiscal policy. Actually, they were victim of poor fiscal supervision. Poor financial supervision. So mostly the banking system was not well supervised. Unfortunately, most of the prudential regulations about lending became more and more accommodative before the crisis. So yeah, it's bad. And when we have to compare the two loans, we can see that there are many things in the paper, but this is what we are coming here. So, duration. ESM, way longer term. So we can see here that the grace period and maturity, long term. Why, in the case of IMF, so we can see that it's still longish, but compared to the ESM, it's medium term. Currency of loan, euro. It's only for euro area, it's only for the member states of the euro area. This is the carrot, actually, right now, to join to the eurozone, because at least you have this kind of funds. Decision-making mechanism, European Commission, and the ECOFIN. You know the ECOFIN is the Council of Finance and Economic Ministers of the member states inside the. Right now, it's just only for the members of the euro area. And also, I mentioned that this 85% of qualified majority, what we can find here. It's good because one country cannot lay against these decisions. And financing, bond issuance in the case of ESM, while funds from member states. So that's why it's different. The problem is that this money, what we have on the table right now, would be completely not able or insufficient to fund any kind of issues in Italy. So hopefully we don't have to have consolidation or bailout or other things in Italy, because in this case, the level of guarantee should be increased dramatically, and also the bond issuance should be increased dramatically. But it would also maybe support the institutional development. Yeah. So if we need some figures, we can say that conditional lending is provided by ESM here, and they are selling the ESM bonds to the foreign investors instead of selling this amount of bond directly to the investors. Yeah. And this is where we are ending today. I hope you enjoyed this, and next time we will deal with World Bank and the BIS, and after that the last chapter will came with the emerging countries and all their features and specialties.